Welcome to this afternoon's lecture by Professor Yosef Soret of Columbia University. We are thrilled to have him here today. And I'll just make a plug for, it looks like his introducer's gonna make a plug too. You'll get two plugs for his recently published book that's getting all kinds of wonderful attention, Spirit in the Dark, A Religious History of Racial Aesthetics. And we'll hear more about that, of course, here in a moment. I just want to mention to all of you that the Danforth Center on Religion and Politics has a few other events this semester. There are flyers outside in Umrath Lounge. Our next is on February 9th. We have a lecture by Cynthia Burek of Ohio State University on the Christian right and LGBT and gender identity rights, human rights. On March 6th, we are very pleased to be partnering with Eden Theological Seminary in screening a new film, An American Conscience, the Reinhold Niebuhr Story. And that film is gonna be screened here. That's a Monday evening over in Emerson Auditorium in Knight Hall. And there will be a panel discussion following that. And then finally on April 4th, we are delighted to be welcoming Michael Curry, who's the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, to give a public lecture here on campus called Healing a House Divided. So we look forward to that. I'm very pleased to have my colleague at the Danforth Center on Religion and Politics, Professor Lerone Martin, who will introduce our guest speaker for today. So Lerone.
Thank you, Marie. So I have the distinct honor and privilege of introducing to some and presenting to others Dr. Yosef Soret. Dr. Soret is an associate professor of religion and African American studies at Columbia University, and we are very excited to host Yosef here today because his research and his public engagement take up some of our nation's most enduring big questions and issues. Issues that are continually seem to be at the fore of the American experience. Questions such as, what is the secular? What is the sacred? And how do these two have anything to do with one another? How do we arrive at these notions? And how do our ideals and practices of the sacred, how are they entangled with our worship, our worldviews, increasingly our politics, for those of you who may happen to read the newspaper once in a while, our understandings of race, sexuality, and propriety. And finally, what are the structures and boundaries and forms for these entanglements and debates? To answer these questions, Dr. Yosef Soret's research draws our attention to the arts and various forms of cultural production. With a PhD in African American Studies from Harvard and a Master's of Divinity degree from Boston University, his research employs keen interdisciplinary analysis to yield multifaceted insights at the intersections of the sacred and art. His first book, which Marie already mentioned, Spirit in the Dark, A Religious History of Racial Aesthetics, was published by Oxford University Press in 2016. This book illuminates how ideas of the sacred have figured into debates about blackness, faith, art, culture, modernity, and politics across the 20th century. Currently, Yosef is at work of two books that continue to explore these themes, one intentionally titled The Holy, Holy Black, The Ironies of an African-American Secular, which is also currently under contract with Oxford University Press, and a third book which examines the recording, consumption, marketing, and politics of gospel music. His research has been recognized and supported with grants from leading foundations and academic centers, including the Woodrow Wilson Foundation, the Eli Lilly Endowment, and as well as work that Yosef has done through the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute for African and African American Research, the Louisville Institute for the Study of American Religion, the Fund for Theological Education, and most recently, Yale University's Institute for Sacred Music, where he's currently a senior fellow. Yosef has consistently brought such rigorous scholarship to bear in his public engagement as well, something we here at the center greatly appreciate and admire about Yosef. His public engagement has taken up some of the most pressing questions facing our democratic republic, including gender and sexual equality, and questions of mass incarceration and rehabilitation. He is the founding director of Columbia University's Center on African American Religion, Sexual Politics, and Social Justice, known as CARS. Dr. Surrett established CARS in the immediate wake of California's Prop 8 when he served as a research assistant for a project that interviewed roughly 100 clergy and lay people in the African American faith communities across the country. With the generous support from the Arcus, Carpenter, and Ford Foundations, CARS was formed. And through Yosef's leadership, the center has convened a group of scholars, activists, and religious leaders, all aimed at advancing academic and public conversations concerning religion and sexual politics. In addition, Dr. Surrett has led a collaborative research project with New York Theological Seminary, investigating their Masters of Professional Studies program, which is housed at Sing Sing State Prison, to examine the relationship between prison education and recidivism. To no surprise, because of his stellar record, his writing and commentary are much sought after, appearing in a range of popular media outlets, including the ABC News, the Huffington Post, the New York Times, the Washington Post, as well as the BBC and NPR. And now we're delighted to add the Danforth Center on Religion and Politics to that list. So would you please help me welcome and join me in welcoming Dr. Yosef Surrett.
Good afternoon. That is fine to respond, that is fine. Want to thank Marie Griffith for the welcome and Lerone Martin for that incredible introduction. Do my best to try to live up to what he has just presented on paper. Want to thank as well the entire Danforth faculty and staff for the welcome and invitation to give this talk. Thank all of you for coming out to what I hope will turn into a conversation. I've tried to organize my presentation as such. It's a privilege to share with you, in fact, what is a talk that is not so much guided by one single strong overarching argument in so much as it's organized around a couple of episodes that brings together two of the projects that Lerone mentioned in his introduction, drawing together reflections on African-American literature, and we'll see whether we'll consider it gospel music, but Christian music in recent memory is debated. It's a site of contestation as whether it's an extension of the tradition of modern gospel music. So I want to bring together literature and music to invite a larger conversation on the theme, the art and politics of African-American faith. Lerone has also foregrounded the sort of pressing social issues of our day. I'm not so sure to the degree to which this project or this presentation will illumine or invite hope and faith as it relates to those pressing issues, but I would invite you to help me make the connections as we draw on these stories and examples to think about their import for our present moment. What I'd like to do as a sort of point of departure in thinking about the study of African-American religion, and my work is in many ways informed by scholars of African-American literature on one hand and scholars of African-American religion, and the desire to tell through these projects a story that brings together sacred and secular, that narrates the religious and the literature as a singular story, to complicate the ways in which religion and literature have been told as separate, but also to push back against a particular narrative or to problematize, as many scholars have done in recent years, a particular narrative of African-American religion as always political, as always in opposition to the state or to whiteness or to white Christianity. And to do that, I want to invite us to think about narrating American religious history through an engagement with African-American art and literature. And to begin, I want to borrow, and often the way in which the Black church is figured as this site of political oppositionality is in light of the weight or the long shadow that the 1960s casts on the present moment. And I want to point to a figure as a way of starting, and in fact, as I attempt to use this multimedia resource here, give you a sense of where I want to go. First, to frame the art and politics of African American faith as this shared conversation around religion and literature and music in a way that brings sacred and secular together. I want to give you two cases of what I refer to as racial Catholicity, which is drawing on Spirit in the Dark, and then turn to something called urban praise at the end of the new millennium, at the end of the millennium, as a way of bringing literature and music together. But to get there, I want to invoke someone who I frame in the final chapter as my book as a contrary spirit in the middle of the 1960s, Albert Murray. And we might think of him as a literary figure inspiring us today as a conversation to think about African-American religion in new terms. And Murray, in pushing back against the orthodoxies of black power, art and politics, in his 1970 book, amongst other things, The Omni-Americans, I want to lay out two quotes that I'll attempt to think through. One, as it relates to thinking about the relationships between black and white, Murray writes, "American culture, even in its most rigid, segregated precincts, is patently and irrevocably composite. It is, regardless of all the hysterical protestations of those who would have it otherwise, incontestably mulatto. Indeed, for all their traditional antagonisms and obvious differences, the so-called black and so-called white people of the United States resemble nobody else in the world so much as they resemble each other." Murray is pushing back against the black nationalist strand of black literature that sought to secede in many terms, at least as Addison Gale outlined it in The Black Aesthetic, from white and Western culture. And as it relates to religion, right, he complicates this black-white oppositionality, but as it relates to religion, he's pushing back against also a host of tropes about black religion as either hyper-political or pathological, as too oriented by otherworldly concerns that it was no political good or always already political, to offer a more subtle analysis of what he referred to as the affirmative powers of black faith. Here I would also invoke an excerpt from The Omni-Americans, where he is drawing on T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland to complicate the ways in which black oppression and white privilege are described, and he tells a story referring to himself in the third person of his great-great-grandfather. He writes, "But he is not cheered by the fix therein. He is sobered by it, as his great-great-grandfather was sobered by the spirituals that sometimes whispered, 'Nobody knows the trouble I've seen when I seen what was really happening in the big house.' No wonder great-great-grandpa took religious salvation so seriously." Right here, we think of this spiritual as emerging from the fields of the black experience of oppression, but now Murray flips that script by turning it into a close proximity to what happens within the big house, which is to say, he makes a case for white folks singing the blues, not to draw sympathy to that white experience, but to recognize there are certain things that are not mediated simply by this racial divide, such that religious salvation that orients oneself outside those circumstances is sometimes necessary. The limits of human liberation often demand of us an effort to transcend on terms that don't always meet themselves out socially. And so I want to bring together Murray's complicating of black and white to bring together culture and politics, to bring together this worldly and otherworldly, to play with tensions between belief and practice in the study of African American religion. And to do so, I want to lift up two examples, or as illustrative of two moments, one from literature, the other from music, that I take to be indicative of the kind of exchange between black and white in the affirmative powers of faith that both frustrate and force us forward beyond the kind of dichotomies that Albert Murray challenged in 1970. To do that, there may not be much that is self-evidently in common between these two examples, other than the fact that they are presumably secular artists offering us new source materials for the study of religion that challenge us to think differently about that familiar adage that all black artists, and especially black musicians, come out of the church. Right? How does religion follow them when they presumably transcend this line that is cast as both from sacred to secular, but is also often cast as black to white, from ministry to the market? How might we think about the way in which religion follows them through these spaces? So for the first example, want to turn to the 1940s. Something that I refer to as racial Catholicity is an effort to bring together, on one hand, an increasing Catholic impulse in Black literature and culture at the time. And by Catholic in this sense, I mean an appeal to the universal. As the 1940s, in a moment of post-war optimism with the gains of the early gains of the civil rights movement, with military service and the push for civil rights growing, there was an increased emphasis, as seen in such anthologies as The Negro Caravan and elsewhere, as art historian Richard Powell sums up the moment, when Black artists were becoming as, quote, conspicuous, cosmopolitan, and candid about their universality and growing political importance in world affairs. And I want to note the connection between this Catholic impulse in Black letters and culture with a moment that also saw the beginnings of a dramatic rise in a tradition of Black Catholicism. That is to say, beginning in the 1940s and the three decades after, we see the growth in number of Black Catholics rise from roughly 300,000 to close to 1 million. So we can think of the 1940s as an especially Catholic moment in African-American culture and literary history. That is to say, the development of a robust claim about Catholicity of Black literature and culture and the lived experience that those forms attempted to represent coincided with a historical moment in which Black people began to join the Catholic Church in greater numbers than ever before. In the convergence of a Catholic sentiment with an expansion of Black participation in the formal traditions of American Catholicism, the beginning of the 40s can be understood as the dawn of a uniquely Catholic and Catholicizing moment in Black culture. The contours of this Afro-Catholic moment also extended beyond the borders of the U.S. as Catholicism enabled key points of exchange between Black artists and intellectuals in the U.S. and those within decolonizing Francophone African and Caribbean nations. For example, Negritude writers such as Aimé Césaire and Léopold Senghor emerged out of contexts in which, unlike the U.S., Catholicism had been the religious rule rather than the exception. However, these international and domestic phenomena were not mutually exclusive. Both patterns signaled a Black internationalist sensibility that became only more pronounced in the wake of World War II. And here we can think about weaving together narratives of the Great Migration and urbanization with the growth of a Black Catholic diaspora and the emergence of a Judeo-Christian sensibility here in the U.S., all aided by military service, civil rights activism, and a growing human rights discourse that took institutional form across the 1940s. Now, to be clear, lest the claim of racial Catholicity, what we might think of as a confluence or convergence or coalescence between the increasing number of Black Catholics and the rise of this Catholic sensibility in the literature, lest we read this too literally, Catholicism was but one tradition through which African-American writers made a new claim on the universal. There was, to be sure, Claude McKay's conversion to Catholicism, and McKay perhaps best represents the convergence of Catholicity and Afro-Catholicism that I'm observing, but there was also Robert Hayden's embrace of the Baha'i faith and Howard Thurman's turn to an interfaith ecumenism. Both Hayden and Thurman sought to inhabit a kind of pluralist post-Protestant religious world that was indicative of this Catholicity. Both men are also fitting examples of the kind of Black religious experience that did not adhere to the normative logic of a simply Protestant Black church. But rather than simply narrating universalism's triumph, a number of Black writers at this time displayed a marked concern with digging more deeply into the specific details of Black life, including, if not especially, Black religious traditions, in service to their assertion of Catholicity. They also erred on the side of valuing craft and cultivating the specific forms most capable of achieving such universality. Here, the particulars of religion figured as a key to arguing that racial aesthetics and thus Black people were, by definition, American and human. Here, African-American religion, as imagined, was claimed as the very stuff of American culture. To give you a couple of examples from this first moment of this Catholicity that I'm gesturing towards, I want to spend a little time with two specific Black writers, Ann Petrie and Robert Hayden, who you have before you. During the 1940s, Ann Petrie was equally busy in the world of literature and politics. She took a position as a reporter at Adam Clayton Powell's publication, People's Voice, which was a gathering space for prominent black radicals at the time. She studied at Columbia under Mabel Louise Robinson and took classes at the WPA-supported Harlem Community Center, which claimed the likes of visual artists Romare Bearden and Aaron Douglas, amongst others. With a fellowship from Houghton Mifflin, Petrie became a full-time writer in 1943, and her first book was published in 1946. Written and set in Harlem, The Street became a commercial success. It eventually sold over 1 million copies, a first for a black woman, and achieved for Petrie a certain measure of literary fame. On aesthetic terms, Petrie was part of a cohort of black social realist artists that included the likes of painters John Biggers and Elizabeth Catlett, poets like Sterling Brown and Langston Hughes, and most prominently, of course, Richard Wright, whose best-selling Native Son was published just a few years earlier. Throughout her work, Petrie was attentive to matters of race and gender as part of a broader leftist political critique. Like Wright, as Farrah Jasmine Griffin has noted, Petrie, quote, saw fiction as the form that could best serve to educate and reform society. Petrie's commitments in this regard were made clear in her essay, The Novel as Social Criticism, which was published in the 1950 anthology, The Writer's Book, edited by Helen R. Hull, another professor of creative writing at Columbia. The book's table of contents read like a who's who in post-war letters, including W.H. Auden, Pearl Buck, Thomas Mann, Lenora Speier, and Lionel Trilling. As the tagline on its cover stated, The Writer's Book was intended to provide, quote, practical advice by the top experts in every field of reading. Petrie's article was the only contribution by a black writer. More personal than practical in tone, her essay was both a general defense of the aesthetics of social realism and a specific response to criticism that her book, The Street, had received in several leftist publications. Significantly, Petrie's essay appeared at precisely the moment that a leftist aesthetic was in the midst of being overshadowed by the rise of the black modernist novel. Yet her arguments hinged less on the idea of either a distinctive racial aesthetic or leftist literary agenda than it did on an appeal to the significance of religious, and that is to say Judeo-Christian and biblical sources for all American writers. To be clear, Petrie was neither an advocate for black churches nor a Christian apologist. Following the overwhelming popularity of The Street, in an interview in the Chicago Defender, Petrie shared, quote, I don't think that church groups even touch the surface of the question, she shared. If Christianity were a living thing, it would be all right, but it does not live, Petrie explained. The bulk of the population gives only lip service to the thoughts of Christianity. Petrie's assessment of American Christians in the Defender did, however, suggest that she held on to something like what we might think of as Judeo-Christian ideals, even if she made no claims to be a believer. In the novel as Social Criticism, Ann Petrie had more to say concerning what she referred to as, quote, the thoughts of Christianity and their implications for the literary canon. Calling attention to inconsistencies between principles and practices of those who espouse Christianity was an age-old tradition in American letters. But here she did more than craft a Christian critique of racism. She theorized the indebtedness of Western literature to Christianity's sacred text. According to Petrie, the basic theme of American literature was, quote, essentially the same. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel my brother? And he said, I know not, am I my brother's keeper? It was this passage that provided the core idea that enlivened the work of the socially conscious novelist, Petrie maintained. Modern literary conventions drew false dichotomies between art and politics while delineating an abundance of distinctive aesthetics, naturalism, realism, modernism, experimentalism. In her estimation, this elaborate professional pattern was in truth, quote, confused patter. In words that closely resembled the speech that Du Bois delivered in an NAACP convention in 1926, Petrie confessed, quote, it seems to me that all truly great art is propaganda. The novel, like all other forms of great art, will always reflect the political, economic, and social structure of the period in which it was created. By 1950, the United States had entered the Cold War, and Senator Joseph McCarthy's anti-communist campaign was well underway. Under this heightened scrutiny, leftist literary circles had taken a serious hit by the time Petrie's essay appeared. In her estimation, a preoccupation with the, quote, perfidious influence of Karl Marx had left a wide range of political novels to be lumped together, even as they fell out of fashion. Indeed, the ghost of Marx haunted the aspirations and expectations of the current literary scene, as she diagnosed it. However, rather than Marxist dogma, Petrie argued that, quote, a fictional emphasis on social problems would be more accurately attributed to the Old Testament idea that man is his brother's keeper. By attempting to shift attention from communism and Marx to the story of Cain and Abel, Petrie situated African-American literature between Marxist ideology on one hand and Christian theology on the other. She astutely noted a connection between the literary trends of her day and the reasonable fear that McCarthyism fomented among American writers. Yet in her assessment, American critics overestimated the influence of Marx at the expense of missing the significance of the Bible. Even if not entirely reducible to Red Scare politics, social realism had fallen out of fashion and Richard Wright had departed for France just 4 years earlier. Within a climate of communist witch hunts, perhaps Petrie thought that shifting attention to Marx, from Marx to the socially acceptable influence of Christian scripture might allow for a more generous assessment of the sociological novel. Petrie went on to assert that the craftsmanship apparent in these books was of a high order. As with all novels, literary success depended on an author's ability to delicately balance thematic concerns with other qualities like character development and dialogue. Form and content were equally important. For evil to have literary power, it had to be made apparent as, quote, both a social system and a thing of the spirit, as Anne Petrie referred to it. Novels had to reveal the human struggle within and without. Novels that addressed the topic of relationships were no different. They no more required a specific literary category than, as the experimentalists insisted, than black people required a special pleading. The Negro problem was the very stuff of fiction, sometimes comic, more often tragic, always ironic, endlessly dramatic, Petrie wrote. All literature had a politics, she explained, from social realism to sentimental fiction. All books ran the risk of failure on artistic terms and no less than other genres. Social criticism solicited emotional responses from readers. Yet she concluded they also encouraged social reforms. Novels disturb readers, in doing so, called society to account. In this way, literature was often the original impetus, in her estimation, for social change. Unlike, ultimately, Petrie's essay affirmed the novel's value as a mode of social criticism, privileging a literary vision in which art and politics were necessarily enmeshed, just as this model of writing was becoming unpopular. Yet she did this at a time when black writers were instead increasingly moving to reimagine, if not wholly undo, such entanglements of art and politics. I want to move to my second example of this Catholicity. Another great example of the kind of Catholic aspirations that animated black literary ambitions in this moment can be seen in the work of the poet Robert Hayden. This was especially evident in the introduction to the Counterpoise series, which he co-edited with Myron O'Higgins in 1948. This is what you see in front of you. Describing the introduction as a manifesto, Hayden was ardently opposed to their writing being received, quote, as the custom is entirely in the light of sociology and politics. Describing the introduction as a manifesto, one critic anticipated that it would become regarded as the entering wedge in the emancipation of Negro poetry in America. If the series failed to achieve this lofty goal, it certainly marked a transition in the poet's aesthetic vision and career trajectory. Hayden had developed significantly as a poet while working for Detroit's WPA Federal Writers Project in the 30s. He then honed his craft further at the University of Michigan in the 40s, where he pursued his master's degree under the tutelage of W.H. Auden. Also in the 1940s, along with his wife Irma, Hayden joined the American Baha'i community. Much later, he would confess to struggling with his faith, but during the mid-40s, the Baha'i emphasis on religious and racial unity paired well with Auden's push for Hayden to move beyond the particulars of racial themes. Indeed, Hayden's poetry wed literary and religious modernisms to great effect. Before the end of his distinguished career, Haydn would be appointed as both the first poet laureate of Senegal and the first black poet laureate of the United States, then considered the consultant to the Library of Congress. Yet when the first Counterpoise leaflet was released, he had just finished studying at Michigan and was settling into a faculty position in Nashville at Fisk University. Despite fellowships from the Rosenwald and Ford Foundations during these early years, it was not until 1960s that Haydn gained a wider hearing. His first publication with a commercial press did not come till 1966, by which point a new generation of artists, those Black Arts Movement poets, were deeming him passé because he refused to identify as a black poet. During the 1940s, however, Haydn's simultaneous emphasis on the particularities of black life and the human universal made perfect sense. While the Counterpoise Manifesto made no direct mention of race, it clearly addressed several audiences at once, eschewing orthodoxies on both sides of the color line. In ways that anticipated Haydn's confrontation with the black arts poets of the 60s, the Counterpoise Manifesto rejected any particular status or category for writers who were so-called minorities. In language similar to that employed by the journalist and race man Roy Ottley, Haydn was, quote, opposed to the chauvinistic, the cultish, to special pleading. While the richness of an African-American experience offered unique resources, they would not allow race politics to, quote, limit and restrict creative expression. Neither would they provide the sort of racial propaganda often called for by race leaders. Irrespective of artistic medium, and they refer to writing and music and the graphic arts, an openness to the, quote, experimental and the unconventional was paramount. Haydn contended that uncritical celebrations of underdeveloped art by a liberal, largely white art world were equally undesirable. Neither a, quote, conscience to solve nor a political axe to grind were due cause for anybody to be overpraised, in Haydn's words. He was not suggesting that mainstream presses were indiscriminately underwriting black mediocrity. After all, he would not himself receive a contract from a commercial publishing house for another 2 decades. To the point, those who presided over publication opportunities, editors, reviewers, anthologists, were not to be granted the power of life and death over an artist's vision. Black leaders and the literary establishment were both served notice. The poet would not be bought, either by affirmation or exclusion. Over the course of his life, Haydn witnessed an evolution of literary acts in which the new Negro transformed to the black arts, although he refused to be ascribed the name by either movement. Rather than an elision of race politics, Haydn's refusal of the modifiers Negro or black was born at least in part out of religious commitment. He later explained, quote, I believe in the essential oneness of all people, and I believe in the basic unity of all religions. I don't believe that races are important. These are all Baha'i points of view, and my work grows out of this vision. Indeed, the Baha'i faith encouraged in its adherence and abandonment of archaic systems and attitudes, the attendant loss of identity, acquisition of insecurity and trepidation. For believers, relinquishing racial identification was part of a process of achieving spiritual maturity. In this view, the Counterpoise series announcement can be read as both an artist's credo and a declaration of faith. Structured something like a hybrid of poetry and prose, the work appeared absent of any definitive beginnings or endings. Its lack of any periods or capitalized letters revealed a modernist emphasis on experimentation and form. The piece perhaps most resembled a religious litany. It reads as a call to action to be recited by a congregation. Indeed, the word believe appears 3 times, once early to affirm experimentation, and then again in each of the manifesto's last 2 lines. Here, Haydn's religious ambitions were subtly unveiled. His insistence that, quote, poetry has humanistic and spiritual values not to be ignored without impunity certainly grew out of his time with Auden, who by the time Haydn arrived at Michigan had begun to think about poetry as a religious vocation. Still, in contrast to Auden's aestheticized Protestant spirituality, Haydn invoked the most fundamental Baha'i principle, announcing a vision that was simultaneously religious and literary, he professed, quote, we believe in the oneness of mankind and the importance of the arts in the struggle for peace and unity. The quintessentially modern religion's first principle, the oneness of mankind, had found a hearing in black communities in the preceding decades. As Abdu'l-Bahá had addressed audiences at the NAACP, Howard University, and Bethel Literary Society at the historic Metropolitan AME Church in DC, to name just a few sites. The Baha'i message of racial equality and religious unity, Baptist, AME, or otherwise, rang true with many black audiences. In the 40s and on the heels of World War II, such ideas sounded anew on both religious and political registers. Various statements endorsing the oneness of mankind had taken on new institutional life with the formation of the UN in 1945. Indeed, as historian Samuel Moyne has shown, one secularizing trajectory that Christian theology traveled across the 20th centuries was into a human rights discourse. In Hayden's manifesto appeared the same year that the General Assembly of the UN adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Hayden's long-held position on the outskirts of the African-American canon was a byproduct, at least in part, of his aesthetic being so deeply Baha'i. Although his poetry drew heavily on the Bible, his version of Afro-modernism was post-Protestant, involving neither a disavowal or declaration of Christian faith. It was ultra-modern, to the point almost of misrecognition. So I'm going to shift dramatically from this example in the 1940s with the cases of Ann Petrie and Robert Hayden, in turn from literature to the music, moving from the 40s to the dawn of the new millennium. So I'm going to play you a clip to frame the story that I want to tell and invite you to think with me for this new project about the relationship between black and white and Christian music in recent memory. And it's supposed to be sideways. Pause there. So for those of you who don't know, this is Chance the Rapper singing How Great Is Our God, backed by a choir in which his cousin is the lead singer. And the question I want to ask, if we could think about the ways in which Ann Petrie's inclusion in the writer's book, or Robert Hayden's mentorship and collaborations with Auden in part of a modernist experimentalist aesthetic, how do we think here in this new moment about the relationship between black and white in the formation of something that comes to be known as urban praise? And the question I want to ask is how we get here to a top, arguably the hottest hip-hop act of last year, covering what is evangelical praise and worship music, right? So he is, in fact, sampling this, or remaking.
Thank you. I'll let it play for a second.
And so chance is interesting for any number of reasons. We might ask how Chris Tomlin, singing here, right, Colorado-based worship leader, highly coveted, sought-after worship leader at the center of these huge conferences or worship experience, how this standard of, I guess we could think of it as contemporary evangelical worship music becomes a source for sampling in contemporary hip-hop, right? And Chance was playing sideways in part because in addition to the content of the lyrics, he released this song via Twitter, and it's meant to be watched on your iPhone, where you can simply turn it. It doesn't quite convert to presentation form. Which is great, right, to think about the relationship between content and form, the music and the medium. And so part of what I want to try to do is offer a preliminary story about how we get from there to here through the emergence of something called praise and worship, in fact, which has a lot of history right here in St. Louis. And that is with the formation of Integrity Communications in the 1960s and 70s. What you have here is a Charismatic Renewal magazine that begins to be published in the 1960s and 70s with the idea of staging live worship experiences that are on one hand meant to teach prayer, authentic prayer and worship, right? I think this is Bob Mumford alongside Bishop Joseph Garlington, who pastors one of the large Black Word of Faith congregations. Mumford helps to start New Wine Magazine, and on the pages of New Wine Magazine, in addition to the articles that are being written as part of a charismatic renewal movement, we see the emergence of a Tape of a Month Club moving from marketing sermons to the growth of what is first the Tape of the Month Club, Integrity Communications, which both creates the market in many ways for praise and worship, and then the music, this is a CD cover, then tape cassettes, but also song sheets, right? And so it's at one point on the pages of this magazine, we see the marketing and distribution and staging of live events around the genre of praise and worship music. There are other trajectories. We can think of Maranatha Music in California, but right here at St. Louis, I think it was the church was called Grace Worship Center. It's changed its name, and it's still alive here in the greater St. Louis area. We see the formation of Integrity Publications, Integrity Media Group, and Hosanna Integrity Praise and Worship as one key outlet. And you could think of this as, if you all remember the Columbia Music Group, where you would sign up for 10 CDs for 99 cents, and then you get one a month. You sign up for Hosanna Integrity, and you could see the sort of standard line, give thanks. There's children's marketing, and they're around. These are all staged live experiences that become CDs, expands to Australia, makes way for what would later be Hillsong, that is now one of the largest praise and worship acts and has churches in LA, Rejoice Africa, Spanish speaking, and then distinctly and then very important is the idea of men in worship, right? And what was central to New Wine Magazine was a biblical vision of Christian manhood. So we see the weaving together of manhood with the media, with the music, with the marketplace, and also a degree of multiculturalism, right? And over time, this music also begins to take a particular Afro-Protestant history, right? So Bishop Garlington, who you saw on that first slide, in his congregation records the Solid Rock. Ron Canole records Jesus is Alive in 89. Alvin Slaughter, who was a lead singer for Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir, records two albums, and all of a sudden we see faces figured on the cover, not just on the back, as Ron Canole is, right? And we can see sort of the expansion. We have overcome, in fact, before these other albums was recorded live in a church out Upper Marlboro, Maryland, pastored by the Mears, a father and son, a white pastorate, all Black congregation. And then early 1991, with Lift Him Up, Ron Canole becomes, in many ways, the face of, and he becomes a world-renowned worship leader. This is a flyer marketing him, I believe, in Africa as the bearer and teacher of authentic worship. He would write a book on worship with Dick Bernal, the church that he led worship up in San Jose.
as his sort of home base. I'll give you an example of how they brought together manhood with multiculturalism and praise and worship music. And perfect neoliberal branding. So there's a way in which a multicultural body of Christ is imagined and staged, black and white worshiping together, filling up, in this case, the Norfolk Convention Center. Ron Canole, prior to this, had a small act as a secular musician covering top 40 music. Didn't work out quite so well, but then becomes the face of praise and worship and is a bridge figure, right? He is black music minister at a primarily or a majority white congregation with a multicultural commitment. Sort of bridge figure to what takes the form of urban praise and worship. As Hosanna then launches its own imprint, you can see the sign that would go on every album. And rather than Canole as the face of this, there's two key figures. One is a person who used to coordinate worship for Promise Keepers, right? And the other is Fred Hammond, who comes to be known as the architect of praise and worship, is a product of Detroit's Pentecostal holiness community. And his recording company would produce all of these urban praise in the house, as sort of code for black praise and worship music. And so we have praise in the house, worship in the house, shout in the house. We see the steady passageway from there, which is Chris Tomlinson, to here, which is Chance, topping the charts with gospel music. And here's just a glimpse of Fred Hammond's career with the group Commissioned, sort of Motown meets praise and worship, solo career, and then as he forms a choir at the same time that he launches this recording studio that produces Hosanna's Urban Line. And then he goes back to praise and worship just last year with Worship Journal. He now is staging these live worship experiences as well. And to capture the market in the media, perhaps as a way to close, give an example of how this comes together in the studio with a veritable who's who of contemporary gospel and praise and worship. So this is Kirk Franklin in the studio at TBN, which you can see down there. So that's Donnie McClurkin on the right, and there's Fred Hammond. So it continues to repeat in this way. Right, just throughout. What's also interesting to think about the gender dynamics is you have four men who are all very well-renowned who lead the solos and are in different outfits, and you have two uniformed black women unnamed in the back in black, right? So there's a way in which there's a resonance between the gender politics on display here and the charismatic renewal on the pages of New Wine, right? And how is it that this comes to be, right, for Chance, taken up as a primary source and one of the top most popular gospel music acts. Now, I say, just as a final thought, and as an invitation to question and conversation, when I presented this idea about how praise and worship becomes a dominant idiom within black churches, something that is connected with Jesus people, hippie Christianity, evangelical Christianity that's red as white, I approached an editor to run this idea by the editor, and the editor said, sort of trying to reimagine the logics of appropriation, said, oh, this is a case of black people appropriating white people's music, right? I'm not quite sure that is the best way to understand the asymmetries of music and culture, but I'm hopeful that you'll help me think through those connections, right? The similarities, the differences in the exchange between black and white that I believe, again, where we began, Albert Murray challenges to think about those asymmetries and similarities on new terms. Thank you. Sure. Yes, Rafi. Oh, yes, please, I was told. Please take the mic, wait for the microphone. Yes.
Hmm.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, no, that's a great question. So how do we account for the dramatic increase in black entrance into the Catholic Church? And I think, right, we could think about the urban encounters between the Catholic Church and black migrants to the cities, which of course is not always a pretty story, right? We think about the origins of white flight now and the different sorts of contestations. I think of the work of McGreevy and others on the sort of forging of Catholic parishes in the cities. But then we also think about the outreach and innovations of the Catholic Church. The CYO, the founding of sort of youth ministries. Claude McKay is, in fact, becomes an advisor on race relations to Bishop Scheel. So there are, who also wrote in publications like Negro Quarterly in the years leading up to this. So there's a sort of attraction and an exchange and at times repulsion, but also an effort to embrace and reach out through the schools and through youth programs that is facilitated by the proximity occasioned by great migration, the migration to the cities. Yes.
And kind of done a lot of research on the history of black Catholics in, well, the area I live in, and grown up there. Also presently doing research in a number of archives here in the St. Louis area on the slaves that the priest and nuns held during free slavery.
Absolutely.
But this question of the black Catholics, it's maybe anecdotal, but in the 1950s, when they were integrating the churches in Louisiana, particularly in southwest Louisiana, which had the highest concentration of black Catholics percentage-wise in any place in the United States, the bishop decided that rather than integrate the churches, because he was afraid that he would lose the black Catholics, he said, no, the black Catholics will keep their own church, because what would happen would mean that, well, you have two churches in this little town, and most of the people predominantly Catholic, and which church you're going to keep? You're going to keep the church that's in better condition, physical building that's in better condition, rather than the building that's kind of run down and needs a lot of work. And most often in these towns, it would be the white church, it would be the brick church, and very well, you know, founded and endowed. And so in one town that we lived in, my wife and I, in Grover, Louisiana, you can stand on the street and look down three blocks and see the
Absolutely, right? And I think your point, there's also a long standing, while there is this uptick in the 40s, there's a long history of Black Catholicism within places like New Orleans and Maryland. So there is a newness, but there's also a longer history of Black Catholicism, yeah. Sure, Professor McCune. Jeffrey, good to see you. Absolutely.
In terms of thinking about Black comedy, like Black Christian comedy, as a site of kind of impersonating, right, church culture that then becomes like, you know, I remember singing, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow," and like, and doing that as a joke to kind of old hymns, right, that we said white folks sang, right?
Oh, right,
and,
right.
And then hip hop being itself, right, or kind of sound. Mm-hmm. Right, which then often responds to the kind of critiques that are embedded in a certain type of comedic, you know, gesture. So for me, there's a lot of genealogies at play there, and maybe discourses that you might want to speak to in terms of thinking about how this happens. But then the last one that I was thinking about that I think is more maybe even more interesting is geography. You brought up St. Louis, but being a Chicago, I'm a little biased. But
yeah. Oh, it's no accident that he's from the home of right.
He's from Chicago. It's no accident that both he and Kanye, right, both have these gospel albums come out in the same year, right? What I would call gospel albums.
And they called both. I mean, in some, well, at least Kanye referred to right as a gospel. Yeah, so those are all great questions. I think you're right to know this. I'm attempting in this, what you saw here, to tell one genealogy that's part of a broader project that is attempting to think about the ways in which two parallel developments, which are often narrated as such, that is this sort of explosion of an evangelical culture industry since the 1960s and the explosion of Black popular culture industry, converge, right, in something, or entangled, or perhaps were entangled for a longer period of time than this, right, but experienced dramatic growth for we could think about it as realignments of the marketed and media, as well as sort of shifting racial discourses. We could think about contemporary gospel, and there's obviously, it makes perfect sense that a Chicago rapper would appeal to, and Chance is very big on, in other songs, of talking about digging into his own roots, not having to leave his old church, not having to soul search. So he makes perfect sense that he would plumb the depths of the particularities of a Chicago experience, right? And so there's certainly a Chicago story to be told there, but there's also, for that matter, in terms of praise and worship lineage, we could think of it not just as a transposing of white folk Christian music, but also the sort of history of the devotionals, right, alongside the hymnody, which has a very similar form. So there are multiple genealogies. As it relates to the comedic question, I mean, I think here, I thought you were actually going someplace different, and to think about the way in which tropes around Black church culture are central to something like the Kings of Comedy, and now we have a King of Comedy who double times as a preacher and advisor to Trump and all sorts of other stuff, but Steve, right? So Steve, is Steve Harvey, how do we discern the difference between when he's caricaturing Black church culture and when he's offering spiritual advice, right? And I think that is also, the way in which the market facilitates that kind of shift would produce a different kind of genealogy, right? Or you think about Preachers of LA, Preachers of Detroit, sort of reality TV remakes the line between the caricature of the performance in ways that I think are not easily dismissed as this is false and this is true, but the context in which those performances are occasioned does matter. Here and then there, and then we'll go back here. One, two, three, yeah.
Okay. I wanna go back to the 1940s to the quote that all great art is propaganda.
Yes, 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 Petrie, yeah.
Because I think when we hear it these days, we have a negative connotation that they did not intend.
Okay.
That's the first thing I want to get your comment on. The second thing has to do, go back to the genealogy question on the worship and praise. Because I'm old enough not to know who the rappers are, and I'm old enough so I don't care.
That's all right. That's all right. That's all.
So, but I am interested in the thing that you have to say in terms of the genealogy of praise and worship, because I think, as you said before, there's a multiplicity of genealogies, much of which goes all the way back to slave hollers, black music,
absolutely.
Dorsey, and the problem that black people have, we have the argument every 20 years or so, whether or not Christian music has gotten too secularized.
Right, right. It's a recur all the way back to the former.
Has changed. Because once upon a time in black church, before church started, there was
devotionals.
Praise and worship,
yep.
Part of the service where the good deacons and everybody stood up and sang to Dr. Watts.
Yep.
I know the Lord, he heard my
right, this is what, that's, yeah, that's exactly, yep.
And then the next thing, as time went on, then you don't get to Dr. Watts anymore, now you get Hammond, now you get praise and worship. And I would suggest to you that it's not always as sexually coded as you gave us today, because we still have the great Shirley Caesar and people like that.
Absolutely. All right, so first to the point about art and politics, or art and propaganda, Petrie is participating in at least two conversations, right? One is a long-standing debate around the idea of black art and culture that, right, we could think of not only Du Bois' speech, which becomes an essay in The Crisis in 1926, The Criteria of Negro Art, but also the debate that year in The Nation between George Schuyler and Langston Hughes, where Langston Hughes talks about the Negro artist and the racial mountain, and George Schuyler the week before refers to the whole idea as the Negro art hokum, right? This sort of critically dismissing the idea there is such a black art. And so, I mean, in between there, Ramir Bearden's essay on the dilemma of the Negro artist, right? And there's a way in which they're pushing back the idea that black art is always overdetermined as a question of race, right? And so part of what both Bearden and Petrie are pushing back, and Hayden as well, is to suggest that segregation makes, there's no logical explanation other than racism for segregation in the social world, and those categories should not then be exported onto the art world, right? Those conventions ought to be undone both in the social world and in the world of arts and literature. At the same time, she's also intervening in a debate between the growing popularity of figures like Baldwin and Ellison and the rise of a modernist novel, and Richard Wright as the most famous black artist at the time, with writing in the social realist tradition, right? And we think of here, quintessentially to this conversation, is Baldwin's critique of Wright, right? As everybody's protest novel, right? And the need for art and literature to move beyond the caricatures of these social types. And part of what Petrie does is complicate that, and to say that form and content, social realism and modernist aesthetics aren't mutually exclusive. There are a set of aesthetic conventions within the social realist novel that has a social purpose that doesn't necessarily take shape at the expense of aesthetic value. As it relates to praise and worship, so I guess to your point around hip hop, I think what's interesting for me in this moment, yes, this is a recurring debate around where the line of sacred and secular is, when the whole story around the formation of modern gospel music is about the idea of bringing the blues into the church, right? The ritual space of the church, and a debate over the sound of it even if it's baptized in Christian scripture. And what's interesting at this moment, as it relates to hip hop, that Chance becomes arguably the most popular secular hip hop artist of 2016, who's now, right, if you're not interested in the content, he's forced the Grammys, right, to create new categories and recognize artists who are not signed to a major label, right, because he released all, he has not signed to a label yet, and he's up for Grammys. And so now, what is it, what's the technical term for downloaded music, right? I'm not, streaming music, right? Does a streaming artist have to be considered, right? Because he's released all his music directly to the internet or to Twitter in a particular way. So he's challenged that. So, but he's topping the charts. How Great Is Our God is not an anomaly, right? The clip right here. This is Chance on Jimmy Fallon, right? I just... So this is, I mean, is this hip hop? Is this gospel? How do we even classify it genre-wise? And what's at stake? And who's, right? So for Chance to be doing this, and yet this was 2 years before this, a relatively unknown Christian rapper. Anybody here know who Lecrae is? Right, very few. But a Christian rapper who comes out of largely white reformed Christian church circles tops the Billboard 200. And ends up fronting the Roots on Jimmy Fallon, right, in October 2014. He's a Christian rapper, right? And now that's also topping the Billboard top charts. And in as he makes this claim on the mainstream, he has a much more tenuous relationship to his church backers who have largely launched him to this celebrity. So there's a way in which the classification of Christian rap versus secular rap, of gospel music versus secular music, whether it's made by the marketplace, whether it's made by the church, whether there's a racial coding to it, as there is in the very classification of urban praise, which is, right, at the same time, urban radio means black radio, as we talk about inner cities, what have you. So what I'm trying to parse through is all those different, to use Jeffrey's, different genealogies that seem to converge in new ways in this moment. Yeah, I mean, Kanye, if we were to go back, was nominated for a Gospel Music Award when he came out with Jesus Walks. And then the group that nominated him rescinded the offer because they listened to the rest of the album and, and determined it wasn't gospel. Right, this is, right. So so we have one, two, sorry, and then, yes. Okay. So yeah, I know you were waiting and then, yeah.
Kind of thinking about the different, as I think about Petrie and Hayden, and I also think about Fred Hammond and Ron Canole, and then I think about Chance, I'm wondering about the sort of different relationships to the market,
yes,
or mm-hmm. different perceived relationships that they have to the market in each of those contexts.
Mm-hmm.
And to go a little bit further into that, I'm thinking about Hayden and his sort of being pushed to the side and sort of shouting the idea of how much capitalist gain he might be able to get off of his work. Mm-hmm. Maybe intentionally, maybe not intentionally, right?
Mm-hmm.
He just couldn't, the avenue didn't open to him.
Yep.
And I'm thinking about Chance making the choice to not sign with a label and sort of do this in his own way, the kind of hybridity that they offer,
yep,
versus the Fred Hammond strain, or versus one could, you know, the Black Arts Movement making its own way.
Uh-huh.
Crazy
yeah, yeah. Your yeah, job. No, well, I may have to interview you so you can answer that question for me, I think, right? I mean, I think, so if I, I haven't given as much thought to the question of the marketplace as it relates to the literary text, but I try to make note of the degree to which, right, Hayden is making these sort of claims at the genesis of his career, and it takes several decades before he signs a commercial contract at the same time that he's dismissed as out of step with the time it is as it relates to black artists. And so whether that's a strategic, or at least it, if we take the words of Credo, it's a strategic choice to not be bought, right? Either by white critics or black leaders, right? And but whether that's also itself a particular position that achieves a certain degree of authority and credibility and fits within another frame, right? And I mean, you say, we talk about chance, right? On the, if I had kept playing either this verse or how he write, I don't write songs for free, I write them for freedom, which has a sort of resonance with Kanye saying, if he writes about Jesus, his record's not gonna play. We know that records about Jesus play well in this particular moment, right? And we also know that artists are making less and less money off of the albums that they have to sign to and making more from the tours. So chance, we could see it as a strike of brilliance that he learned before he signed that he was actually gonna make more money when he was on the road with Childish Gambino and others, and didn't need Kanye to sign. He could maintain creative control, right? And yet it also positions him to make a claim for a degree of political autonomy in ways, so the sacrifice sort of serves a market purpose in a different way. I don't know if that gets at some of the questions you're, yeah. All right, here and then Marie. Good. Oh, and why is black theology not followed within most black churches?
Right.
Got it.
I think what is the main reason? And my second question is...
It's a great question.
Yeah.
You want to answer that one?
And the difference between black theology and the black power movement and black art movement.
Oh, so relationship between black theology, black power, and black arts. Okay, yes, all right. Maybe I could start there before answering the larger question. So, I mean, we could think of black theology if we want to trace it through, I guess, two of the leading proponents, one in the pastorate and one in academia, James Cone and Albert Clegg in the 1960s, right? As a direct response to the claims made about race and religion by the black power movement, both in its aesthetic and organized political form, right? There's, Cone writes at length about feeling as though, you know, his Christianity was called to task in light of the claims of black power, and so he writes a black theology in order to defend or re-articulate Christian faith in light of the legitimacy of black power's critiques of the, I guess, impotence or inadequateness of black church's ability to deal with the racial turmoil of the 1960s. I think if we turn to the black arts movement, at least as I try to write about it in Spirit in the Dark, there's at least three developments that we can see. One, it is like to follow Kleege and others, right? Kleege, who, right, as part of his installation of a black theology in his church, adorns the wall with this large image of the black Madonna. And so this idea of creating a new iconography, a new aesthetic that represents a black theology, a black liberation theology, is central, right? And so he's not alone in doing that. But then you also have central theorists of the black arts like Larry Neal, who argue that black power activists are going to have to take the church more seriously, right? And so there's, a number of ways in which black arts movement figures engage with Christianity and try to reimagine it on more radical terms. Larry Neal referred to it as a new spirituality. You also have, right, with Malcolm X, who's often figured as a patron saint. We think of Dudley Rose's anthology for Malcolm in 1965 in the aftermath of his assassination. And there's a way in which black Islam is appealed to as the true religion of the black man, and black women and black men take this up who are in the black arts movement. Amiri Baraka, as one of the stories he tells about why he divorced himself from the downtown scene and created the Black Arts Repertory Theater, was in part because of Malcolm's assassination, right? And so Islam figures in how he refigures himself as Imamu Amiri Baraka. And then a third is, in the 1960s, also a renewed appeal to Africa as the an African-derived religious traditions. We think of Baba Osejiman's Yoruba Temple in Harlem. In this effort to appeal to African-derived religions as an authentic bearer of black identity. So both in an appeal to Africa, in an Islam, and a reimagining of Christianity, we see all those things taking place within the black arts movement. As it relates to black theology not seemingly taking full shape within black churches, I think this is where one of the reasons Albert Murray is so important. Right, the vast majority of African American churches are largely evangelical in their orientation. Right, the terms under which black folk in large number embraced Christian faith was the evangelical revivalism of the 19th century, and black theology. But it was a different kind of evangelicalism, right, that had more organic connections to the women's movement, to abolitionism. Right, so there was a way in which politics. A progressive politics was organically tied up with an evangelical worship experience, and there, at least in large part, is not a similar pairing in more recent iterations of black theology. We get a very impassioned articulation, but perhaps not the same sort of worship experience to go with it. And it's often read as an export, right? Or an import from a foreign source to the churches. So, and largely read as a secular one, right? We might ask what secular stands in for there. Yes. Thank you. That was a great questions, Marie and then Gerald.
So, these are great materials. I guess I'm curious. So, the first part of your talk was about words. Right?
Yes, that's right.
In terms of music.
Yep. Yes.
And just thinking about these endless kind of appropriations and going back and forth, I mean, I haven't thought a lot about praise music since I finished the research on women's and
yep.
Predominantly white circles. But,
yep.
You know, those were certain kinds of lyrics that were very intentionally, in their view, not political.
Yep.
And they were status quo, political, of course.
Yep.
And so I'm thinking about, wow, you know, then you've got all of this other. That I would think you have already suggested that has, you know, this a more political side to it, and I'm wondering what happens then with those appropriations, and when you've got these racial mixed congregations, you know, can you tell us a story about just the lyrics and the message that's going on there,
yeah.
Or is it all just trying to be apolitical?
So. Yeah, I mean, this is, I guess, the question I would ask, and I don't know that I have the answer to this yet, but I'm trying to figure out how to think about the relationship between content and form, right? Because in the same way that devotional services take up these traditional hymns from the 19th century, there's very little done lyrically. When you see Kirk Franklin playing How Great Is Our God, it's the same sort of vision of personal piety that, if not explicitly articulated as such, we might read as depolitical, individualized, spiritual connection directly to God. It doesn't seem to narrate the sort of long history of black freedom that's associated, right? If we think of one way of reading gospel music is the soundtrack of migrants moving to the north and to the city. But in that regard, then we might read praise and worship as part of the passage into post-racial America that has a particular kind of currency in, right, in spaces. At the same time, there is something distinctly there is something distinctive that, whether it be Fred Hammond or the figures that we've seen here at Chance, that, I mean, here I think about Stuart Hall's idea, what is the black, what is this black in black popular culture? Chance is not Chris Tomlin, right? That there's a distinctive, we might call politics, to the way in which he performs a black version, right? Now, it's not a pure, if we, right, but we're in a moment where we take for granted that there are no, if we take a lead from Stuart Hall and us, that there are no pure forms. And that's, again, I think where Albert Murray's theorizing of the entanglement is not to eschew the asymmetries of race and politics, but is to call for a language that doesn't flatten out those, right, doesn't flatten out those differences, but also recognizes that even in the most segregated precincts, there's a whole lot that's shared. And so I'm still trying to figure out how to write about that, but in large part, the lyrics are, I mean, who's the praise and worship, I mean, he's very much in this idiom, he's sort of neo-soul meets praise and worship, Travis Green, I think, is it, that who was invited and accepted the call to go sing at the inauguration. And his most popular song is what, all things are working for my good, right? So there's is also a hint of a prosperity, personal actualization message. So it's very neoliberal, whatever that might, right? So that's a long way of saying yes. It's very political, even if the lyrics are, yeah. Sorry, thanks, yes.
Mm-hmm. One, I think, would be, which you don't mention, but I think you might want to think about me. One is the rise of a global philosophy called existentialism,
yep.
Which
okay.
opens the door for black writers because it's a philosophy that so appeals to literary people. It opens the door for black writers to begin to talk about black individualism.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so at least the novels in the early 50s, like William Dempsey's Beetle Creek or Richard Rice's
Yeah.
Explicitly black existential novels.
Yep, yep.
The other thing is the rise of what in America became known as a middle ground culture. Mm-hmm. And the rise of the middle ground culture, I think, had a particular impact on African American music. And I would say it directly relates to the rise of technology in the late 1940s called the long playing record.
Mm-hmm.
The long playing record changes, for instance, how people see jazz music. And it's as a result of a long playing record that people listen to jazz differently, but also artists look at how they present their music differently because a long playing record can give you a more a truer view, a truer understanding of what jazz music is as opposed to the 78s where you only hear 3 minutes
yeah.
on the side. So it could be argued that the rise of this music helped to create the rise of jazz, of middle ground music, which clearly happened in the 1950s,
mm-hmm.
Its status rose to kind of middle ground music.
Yeah.
So those would be two things I would mention as rising out of the 1940s that would affect the very phenomena that you're talking about with Petrie and with Hayden.
Yeah, no, wow. So, I mean, I think in ways that with regards to your second point, I think that, I mean, I take that as a sort of serious challenge, sort of the limits of a sort of just attention to the text themselves, right? Is a reimagining in that moment also the relationship between content and form and how it shapes literary production, one that I'll admit I don't do in the book. As it relates to existentialism, I don't pay an extended deal of attention to existentialism in particular, but to the sort of cross-pollination and international networks that are forming in these literary circles, certainly, absolutely. And that is part of the sort of broader discussion of both Petrie and Wright and the host of figures that are both in conversation at conferences and right and the like. So that's part of the conversation I'm now looking forward to rewriting the second edition of that will take that more seriously. That's a, thank you.